What up, everybody? This is your boy Tech G checking in, and today we're going to talk about data types, ladies and gentlemen. Data types. So you're going to learn about stuff such as char. You're going to learn about stuff like strings, numbers, and this thing called Boolean logic. Oh my, we're going to have some fun today, y'all. Woo! All right, let's go ahead and get into it. So char, the abbreviation char is used as a reserve keyword in some programming languages such as C, C++, C Sharp, and Java. Char is short for character, which is a data type that holds one character of data, which could be expressed as a letter, number, etc. The value of a char variable could be any one character value, such as 1, 2, AX, Z, the dollar sign, the asterisk, etc., etc. So that is what the term char refers to. Next we have, a char also equals 1 byte. So next we have a concept called strings. And a string is a data type used in programming to represent text rather than numbers. It is comprised of a set of characters that can also contain spaces and numbers. For example, you can have a phrase like, quote, I love computers, or quote, happy 1, 2, 3. Now, typically, computer programmers must enclose strings with quotation marks for the data to be recognized as a string and not a variable name or number. Strings are also used to execute scripts that connect strings to a variable, such as this. So here's an example of a script right here. You type this bad boy up. Put $string equals I love computers. You type the command print, what do you love, followed by the string variable, and the output will be, what do you love? I love computers. See how that works, ladies and gentlemen? Now, strings can also be a variable of fixed, strings can also have variable or fixed lengths. For example, if a string has a length of 10 characters, but you attempt to enter more than 10 characters, all characters after the 10th character will be cut off, and this is called truncation. So here's an example of truncation. If you look at your screen here, you'll see at the top there's a 9-character string limit to enter the name Bob space Smith. If you were to implement an 8-character string limit and you try to enter the name Bob space Smith, you see that the letter H has been cut off. That is known as truncation, ladies and gentlemen. So data entry designers, they need to take into account both typical and larger examples of proper names or other data when sizing data entry fields. So those guys need to be wary of that type of stuff. Next, we're going to talk about numbers. And numbers are the most common data types, and they come in mainly two forms, integers and floats. So we have integers. An integer is a positive or negative whole number with no decimal points or fractions. Examples of integers could be numbers such as 1, 2, 10, 50, or negative 1, negative 2, negative 10, negative 50, etc. The number 0 is also considered an integer, even though it has neither a positive or negative value. In most programming languages, you can convert a number into an integer by using the int function. So if you had the number 4.5 and you typed in a command to an int function command, it will convert 4.5 into the whole number 4. Now, this could be useful when seeking to obtain a whole number value after randomizing a range of numbers. So here's an example written in the programming language Perl. So if we look at this script here, it says my $random equals int random 50, pound int random 50, and print random number between 0 and 50. So essentially, this script will generate a random number between 0 and 50 once it is executed, ladies and gentlemen. Next, we're going to talk about floats. A float, which is also known as a floating point number, is a number that contains up to 7 digits and has at least 1 decimal point. A float represents real numbers and is written with a decimal point dividing the integer and the fractional parts. So here are some examples of floats. 3.14, which equals pi. But you have this other decimal number, 5.9 and 0.404. These are floating point numbers, ladies and gentlemen. Now, the float variable is often used to include currency values in computer language. Programmers can programmers can designate the number of placeholders after the decimal by using additional commands on a float variable. In general, floats use the same operators as integers in similar ways. The addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division of these variables is fairly straightforward in most cases. So here goes some examples of the powers of 10 and the powers of 2. When used as floats, you can have the number 6.5 times 10 to the fifth power. That'll get you 6,550,000. If you did the opposite, 65.5 times 10 to the negative fifth, that'll get you 0.000655. Here's an example of 51.12 times 2 to the 12th power. That gets you that very big number there. And here is the complete opposite. If you took 51.12 and multiplied it by 2 to the negative 12th power. So these are examples of floats when you apply them to powers of 10 and power of 2 examples. Next, we're going to talk about Boolean. So in computer science, a Boolean value, which is also called a bool, B-O-O-L, is a data type that has 2 possible values, true, which is represented by the number 1, or false, which is represented by the number 0. Boolean logic is named after the English mathematician George Bool, whose algebraic and logical systems are used in all modern digital computers. Boolean values are binary. Boolean logic is used to determine if a circuit is charged or not, which will be represented by the number 1, or if it's not charged, which will be represented by the number 0. Boolean logic can also be used for searches using the following comparisons: and, or, not, or XOR. So here are some examples of, this is what the search statements actually mean. So if you use the Boolean statement and, this stands for if both values 1 and 2 exist in a statement, then the statement is true. If only value 1 or value 2 exists in a statement, the statement is false. When you're using the Boolean phrase or, that stands for if either value 1 or 2 exists, the statement is true. When you're using not, it stands for if neither value 1 or 2 exists, statement is true. If either or both exist, the statement is false. And then you have the XOR, that stands for if either values 1 and 2 exist, the statement is true. If either both exist or if neither exists, the statement is false. You're like, man, that seems confusing. Yeah, it really does. But it's really not that confusing. So here's another example of Boolean written in plain English, ladies and gentlemen. So just imagine that you were logging into a college library online, going to search around in their database. When you're out there, you can actually utilize Boolean logic, or you can actually apply this to a Google search on Google. So here's an example. Let's just say you went to Google and you typed, or not even Google, but just the library database, like the example says. It says, if you typed in a library database looking for toys, you might find 244 results if you just typed in toys, right? If you typed in the database looking for cars, you might produce 300 results, all right? But what if you typed in the database that you were looking for toys and cars? Well, you might only come up with 10 results because out of those 10 results, out of the toys and the cars, only 10 of them could actually be classified as has been classified as a toy and a car. What if you typed in the database that you were looking for toys or cars? Well, you might end up getting 400 results because you were essentially telling the database to retrieve everything that has been marked as a toy or a car, and now it's going to spit out 400 results for you. So that is an example of how you can use Boolean in plain English when you're trying to search a library database or if you're trying to find something using Google. Another way that Boolean could be applied, Boolean could be applied as an algebraic equation. So here's an example of that. If X equals 1 and Y equals 1, then X and Y will equal 1. If X equals 1 or Y equals 0, then X or Y will equal 1. If X equals 0, then not X, X will not equal 1. So, seems a little confusing. Don't worry about it. Like I keep saying in the previous videos, this course is just designed to get you familiar with the concepts, not turn you into subject matter experts. Depending upon the path in IT you choose to go, let's just say you want to become a programmer who learns Python and C++, well, you're going to get thoroughly educated in this stuff when you start taking those classes. Another way you can apply Boolean logic, you can display it as a Venn diagram. So here's an example of a Venn diagram, ladies and gentlemen. So what this Venn diagram is showing you is this. It shows that Burger King and Taco Bell, they both make fast food. But Burger King does not make tacos, as Taco Bell does not make burgers. So that is how this Boolean logic can be represented in a Venn diagram as well. All right, everybody get that? Cool beans. So let's go ahead and do some check on learning, ladies and gentlemen. Check on learning. All right, so the values 74.76, 12.8, and 0.2537 are examples of which of the following? Would it be a float? Would it be integers? Would it be Boolean logic? Or would it be string variables? The answer is these are floats. Remember, floats represent decimal numbers, ladies and gentlemen. So when you think of the word float, just think of decimals. Next question. If a string has a length of 12 characters and you attempt to enter more than 12 characters, the last characters will be left off. What is this called? Is this called truncation? Is it called Boolean logic? Is it called char overflow? Or is it called floating point? The answer is truncation. Truncation, ladies and gentlemen. So you guys will remember I showed you the picture of the name Bob space Smith. And then on the bottom example, it had Bob space Smith, but the H on Smith was cut off because the characters were set to less than what the previous number for the characters were on Bob space Smith. And finally, Which of the following orders would you use at the Boolean hamburger stand if you want to get a burger with pickles and ketchup, but no mustard or onions? So how would you turn this into a Boolean statement written in plain English is what this is asking. Would it look like this? Burgers and pickles and ketchup or mustard or onions? Would it look like this? Burgers and pickles, not ketchup or mustard or onions? Will it look like this? Burger and mustard or onions, not ketchup or pickles? Or would it look like this? Burger and ketchup and pickles, not mustard, not onions. So remember, it says, which of the following orders would you use at the Boolean hamburger stand if you want to get a burger with pickles and ketchup, but no mustard or onions? How would you put that order into Boolean logic? The answer is as follows. You would write your order as burger and ketchup and pickles, not mustard, not onions. Because remember, you wanted to get a burger with pickles and ketchup, but no mustard or onions. So this is how you would submit your order in Boolean logic, ladies and gentlemen. So that is pretty much all I have for this video discussing data types, ladies and gentlemen. If you want to get more information, you can visit my website at technologyg.com, where you can read, where you can read all of this great, wonderful stuff yourself so that you can become an expert on data types and pass your CompTIA IT fundamentals exam. All right, till next video. Peace.